I think it's on. Is it on? Yeah, it's on. Good morning, y'all. Or good morning, everybody. And everybody up there, good morning. Good morning. How are y'all doing this morning? Are we ready this morning?
We are ready.
Everybody opened their hearts up this morning? I hope so.
Yes.
All right. Responsive reading. And the angel said to them, "Be not afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy which will come to all the people.
For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord.
But you, O Bethlehem Ephrath, who are little be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days.
She will bear a son, and you will call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins."
All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet.
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased."
Let us bow our heads. O Heavenly Father, help us to always remember what this season is all about. O Heavenly Father, we pray that everybody will come together in peace and worship you as we should. And Lord, as we go in this day, help us, O Heavenly Father, to understand what we are taught today. This we pray to you in your wonderful name. Amen.
Everybody this morning, and all you Facebook viewers out there, thank you for joining us. I want to remind you of a couple of very, very important announcements regarding Christmas. If you got your evangel or you came in and you saw tickets out there, they cost you nothing, but we're doing that to sort of regulate our Christmas Eve services. Because sometimes Christmas Eve, we never know We never know how many people will choose to come to a Christmas Eve in-person service or not to come. We just don't know that. And we're not doing this gigantic polling of people like we have time to do that. So we've decided that we're going to do a 4 o'clock and a 6 o'clock service on Christmas Eve. And you need to pick up a ticket, and you need to stay true to that. So if your plans change, I get it. We're going to have a few extra situations. But try to stay true. If you're going to come to the 6 o'clock and you've picked up a ticket, come to that. You don't have to bring your ticket. We're not going to, like, keep people from our Christmas Eve service, right? But we're trying to keep the social distancing thing. We're trying to, so we don't have 100 people show up all at once. We're trying to protect people and do our part. So we just ask that today they're out there. If one is gone today, one ticket's for a service, then those at the other service will be available. So 4 and 6 o'clock, pick them up. And if we have to make more, we will. But that's 100. And we know that some of you are going to bring some of your relatives to a Christmas Eve service. I encourage that. That's why we're creating 2, to keep kind of people distant a little bit. So that's on Christmas Eve. Next Sunday will be our Christmas choir cantata. So the morning service, that'll be at 10 o'clock. The choir will probably have close to an hour, maybe, I suppose. And we'll do some congregational singing. I'll take a break from preaching. I don't know what that means for me during the week, just maybe more fishing, right? This weather is wonderful. So anyway, prepare for that. Invite people to that. That's going to be a normal Sunday service, so we've got plenty of space for that, I suppose. So I'm more concerned about Christmas Eve, I guess. Now, for those of you that are members of our church, we're going to have a short business meeting after the service to approve our next year's budget. A lot of work has gone into that. Our board's approved it. So that's part of our church makeup, is that we'll approve that going forward into 2021. Okay, before the choir comes up and we kind of continue celebrating the Lord through communion, let's just have a word of prayer. We're so grateful, Jesus, for your power and your presence. Maybe we scrambled to get here this morning, and we didn't have time to say, good morning, Lord. Speak afresh to me, that I would see your mercies that are new. Encounter us this morning in this worship service gathered together, that we're not just doing church. We're not just going through the motions. We know that. We're not criticizing ourselves for that. We're just saying, Lord, reveal your love, your word, a quickening word of your grace to every one of our lives. I also recognize that the Christmas season can be very, very difficult for some, because of past memories, losses, or anticipation of, gee, I don't know what's going to happen this month. So raise our expectations this morning. And I pray, Father, that our Christmas celebration would be filled with your love and your power and your grace and your healing more than ever before. I pray for any of us, including myself, that perhaps spend our time worrying or concerned about finances or concerned about this or that or people or healing needs. May we be so refreshed in your love and your power this Christmas season. I pray specifically this morning, Lord, for people that need healing. Healing of their heart. healing of broken places in all of our lives. As we receive communion this morning, as we celebrate the Last Supper, may there just be healing power that would go forth as we worship you. A lot of people need physical healing, a refreshing touch from you. We lift our friends and our loved ones to you. Many of us have people that are not walking with you, loved ones that are not walking with you at all. And we know that. We're not trying to judge them. They're just not walking with you. We pray for them right now that this Christmas season they would make a turn back to the manger and say, I need to rededicate my life. But that said, Lord, we all need to come to the cross and the manger to rededicate our lives and say, Lord, have your will, have your way in my life. So we just thank you for this time of prayer, this time of worship, as we proceed with our service, that you'd be so honored and blessed as a gathered body. We pray for the upcoming Christmas things, the things that we will do, things that you will lead us to do from this morning until the 25th of December that we did not individually or corporately plan on doing, but your Spirit will lead us. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, the choir will come up.
It's a reading from the book of Luke, chapter 18, verse 9. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying this, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even this tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. Dear Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you that you teach us, you communicate with us, you give us lessons, you give us messages that we could not otherwise get without your word. Help us to understand, help us to grow, help us to apply these things to our life. And I thank you so much for people like pastors and ministers who can understand this just a little more and can help us make sense of it. And Jesus, just be with us today. Amen.
I trust that you have your communion elements in hand. I had Stephanie read that great parable. It's not the usual Christmassy way to introduce communion. Two people went to church. One person compared themselves to other people and felt like they were spiritual and righteous because on a scale of 1 to 10, they were like a 9. But Jesus said that person goes home just empty. Rather, the tax collector, one of the most despised people in that day, just said, God, be merciful. I need you. I need you today. He saw his own sin. He saw his own brokenness. He saw his own need for humility. Now, my point is not to preach that parable. I have another sermon prepared. It's to remind us that this is a moment of communion that we need to deal with with us, not with somebody else. We, all of us individually, have enough brokenness within us. Though we're whole in Christ, we have enough things that need to be kind of repaired by his healing grace that we don't need to look at another person. Yet we kind of spend our time doing that, don't we? Whether we look at the culture or we look at somebody in church or somebody, how could they do that and call themselves a Christian? We need to look at our own lives. We need to fall once again at the cross and say, you came into the world, Jesus, to save sinners. And no, Paul, you're not the chief of sinners. I am. I think we'd all say that. We better say that. Yes, we're saved by his grace and we have a new identity in Christ, but we still have things in our life. And if it weren't for the grace of God, where would any of us be today? Do I hear a witness to that? So with that, let us receive the bread and the juice, saying, Lord Jesus, I need you more than ever before in my life. And you're in my life. I just need a touch of your grace. I recognize my faults, my sin, everything. Jesus said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Eat. And then Jesus took the cup and he said, this is poured out. My blood is poured out for the forgiveness of sin. drink all of it.
Thank you. thank you that you were crowned king, that you are the King of Kings, because you made us kings, kings and priests. So we thank you, Lord, that we are not assuming anything to take that title, because you gave it to us, and you are the King of all kings. Thank you, Jesus, also, that you came as a lamb and rose as a lion and gave us the template for living life, not to be blindly following, but to step into sonship, to step into life and living and leading others as lions and taking care of wolves. So we thank you for that, Lord. Thanking you also that you gave us the Holy Spirit to have the power and the life to do this. We bless you today, Jesus. And thank you so much for coming. Amen. You may be seated.
So the title of today's message is Expecting Anything. This is the second Advent Sunday. It represents many things to the Christian world. Some call it the Candle of Bethlehem. That's what I put in the bulletin. Some call it the Candle of Hope. Last week we talked about preparing for the Christmas season. This morning I'm going to talk about expectations. If you have a Bible with you, turn with me to Luke chapter 2. There's an often forgot figure in the Christmas story, though it's a little bit later after Jesus was born. His name is Simeon, and I'm going to use him as a model of expectations. Expectations. Expecting anything. Sometimes I wonder if we go through the Christmas season, do we expect anything good? The series is Good News of Great Joy. Do we expect any great joy? Do we expect any great news? Yes, we celebrate Jesus' birth. That's wonderful. That's the epitome of celebrating good news of great joy. And so I'm going to unpack that a little bit this morning. Simeon. Verse 22, Luke chapter 2. When it came time for the purification according to the law of Moses, they brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. Verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. We don't know if he's a prophet. We don't know what he did, but he was in Jerusalem. He was in the temple. I think he was kind of a prophetic guy, and he's an unusual guy. And the holy, he was righteous and devout. He was looking for, my translation has, the consolation or the hope or the comfort, the good news of great joy for Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. As the Holy Spirit indwelt him, so the Holy Spirit indwells us. The Holy Spirit indwelt him. The Holy Spirit was upon him. And this is an unusual thing. Verse 26, it had been revealed to him. We don't know at what point it was revealed to him, but it had been revealed to him that the Holy Spirit, that he would not see death, he wouldn't die until he had seen the Lord's Christ. Now, that could have been 5 years before this moment. We don't know that. It just had been revealed to him. But verse 27, it kind of quickens it. And inspired, my translation has inspired by the Spirit. He came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus, it was like bingo. He had never met them before. That's the couple. And there he is. To do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and he blessed God. It was a worship moment. Lord, let me depart in peace now. I'll talk about that later at the end of the sermon. According to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared in the presence of my people. All peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to thy people Israel. And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, a prophetic word here, behold, this child is set for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is spoken against, and a sword, Mary, will pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts out of many hearts may be revealed. Well, like I said, I want to talk about expectations this morning. And I'm sure you might know who this person is because something happened in his life in the summer of 1741 that he didn't expect to have happened. Who was that? George Frederick Handel. Michael Brown writes about George Frederick Handel in the development, the writing of the Messiah, the music to it, as it's called that today. But somebody's got my copy of Michael Brown's book, The Power of Music, which I originally got this from. So Karen did a little research for me and found basically the same thing online. And I'm going to read a couple of paragraphs that he didn't expect to have happen for him in the summer of 1741. Deeply depressed. And I understand from other reading that Handel was kind of an ornery guy. He knew his Bible very well, and he told the Puritans, I know my Bible very well. I love that he told the Puritans that. Deeply depressed. And some other financial things had caved in on him. His music wasn't going anywhere. Deeply depressed, Handel was visited by his friend Charles Jennens. The wealthy, devout Anglican had written a libretto. I have no clue what a libretto is. About the life of Christ and the work of redemption with the text completely taken from the Bible. A fussy perfectionist. Jennens had written it to challenge the deists who denied the divinity of Jesus. Then he said, would Handel compose the music for it? When asked, Handel answered that he would compose the music to this libretto, The Life of Christ, and estimated its completion in a year. Okay. Soon thereafter, a group of Dublin charities approached Handel and to compose a work for the benefit performance, and the money raised from this performance would help free people from debtor's prison. And Handel would receive a commission from this as well if he paid for doing it. Now with text and a motivation, I'm doing this to help others, to get them out. In those days, if you owed debt, you went to prison. Hallelujah. We still owe debt, but we don't go to prison, right? And he would receive something for it. Now with the text and a motivation, beginning on August 22nd, 1741, he began composing the Messiah. Right, is it going to take him a year? This is what he did not expect. It was a miraculous, divine intervention. Within 6 days, part one was finished. In 9 more, part 2, 6 more days, and part 3 was done. It took him only an additional 2 days to finish the orchestration. Handel composed like a man obsessed. He rarely left his room and rarely touched his meals. But in 24 days, he had composed 260 pages, an immense physical feat. When he finished writing what would become known today as the Hallelujah Chorus, he said, I did think, I did see all heaven before me and the great God himself. Isn't that something? And if you think it went off without a hitch, no, it did not. Like all music, it seems, in Christian circles, the Messiah was controversial. Did you know that? It was not accepted at first. And you thought the praise songs we did ruffle your feathers. Go figure on that one. I want to talk about expectations. He did not expect what would happen to him that happened to him. It almost sounds like a contradiction. How do you expect the unexpected? I don't know. But what I want to do this morning is I want to try to raise your expectations this Christmas season. What do you expect? What do I expect? What can we expect from God? And I'm going to use this character, Simeon, this devout, righteous, I call him a prophet. Most scholars probably don't, but he said prophetic things. He had some expectation brewing within him about, because it was revealed that he would not die. Think of that. He would not perish and go to heaven until he had seen the hope of Israel. And he actually got to hold the hope of Israel in his arms. Think of that. So what do we get out of this passage? What's the good news of great joy? Expectations. I'm going to unpack three bullet points. I always have to have some bullet points. I want to have direction here. I want to unpack some expectations that aren't out there. They're just, I want to raise your eyes. I want to raise my spirit a little bit this morning. Number one, this Christmas season, expect to be encountered by God. I know you already have been. I'll talk about that in a moment. One of the greatest themes of the Christmas story and the Christmas narratives in the New Testament is the fact that every character was uniquely, miraculously encountered by God through angelic visits, through dreams, through circumstances that changed their life. Simeon was encountered by the Holy Spirit too, but his is a little softer, a little more gentle. It was revealed to him, verse 27, that he would not see death. And then inspired by the Spirit, he's in the temple. And I believe it was a spontaneous kind of a combustion in his spirit. Boom. They were all encountered by God. So what do we do with that? What do we do with that? Well, I'm not going to stand in front of you and stand in front of a Facebook audience and say, okay, this Christmas season, be encountered by an angel. That'd be cool. I've never seen a supernatural angel, although I had a congregant one time, and I remember that morning, I was just burning with heat, and it was in December, but our sanctuary, I think it was on air conditioning, because it was kind of small, and I was burning with heat, and she said, there was a light behind you, and it never moved. I trusted Janet. She was just an awesome lady, and she kept focusing on this light behind me. I've never seen an angel. I've seen some angels. I've been visited by angels unawares, I believe. People disguised as human beings, I believe. Where did they come from? Why did they say that? And where did they go? I believe that, and I believe you probably have too, had that experience. So here's what I'm going to suggest to you this morning about expect to be encountered by God. I want to raise our expectations a little bit. Here we go. I want to unpack three or four things of what that could mean in our life. Number one is this. Are you ready for number one? I would say number one is the Spirit reveals that something is not right in your life. This is the sin part. I love that Zoom class. I won't be attending it tonight. I'm going to be doing some holy rolling this afternoon at Crow Agency. Right? That was a joke. That was never mind. Okay, it's beautiful weather this afternoon. We're going to get some painting done. Listen, and I love what Linda's been doing about trying to help us redefine words to communicate to an unchurched audience. How do you communicate sin? So I just did it this way, that the Spirit reveals something isn't right in your life that we need to repent of. It's called sin. It's called a virus. It's called actions and attitudes that aren't pleasing to God. And you know, well, I don't want to hear that, Pastor. I just want to hear my identity in Christ. I want to hear some Yes, we have righteousness in Christ. We also have a fallen nature, and things aren't totally perfect in our life. Do I hear an amen on that? All right, so that's a God encounter. There was an ancient monk, Sir Isaac of Nineveh, who said, "He who sees his own sin is greater than he who sees angels." I like that. Are you afraid to look at some things in your life that maybe aren't right? I think that's a God encounter. I think that's a huge God encounter. The Spirit just wants to correct some things in all of our lives. Number two, I would say this, his powerful presence. I just want more of him every day. Every day with Jesus is, finish the line, sweeter than the day before. It should be that way in Christianity. It should be that way in our daily life. That more of him, more of his peace, more of his love, more of his joy in our life. I think every morning you ought to wake up and say, "Thank you, Lord. Mercies are new every morning." That's a God encounter. Here's number three that I think could be a huge God encounter for every one of us. We rededicate and humble ourselves. This Christmas season, might we all not just live with our head theology or, "Well, I'm going to services, Pastor." Might we all, in a refreshing and renewing way, humble ourselves before Almighty God and say, "I just want your will in my life." How about that for a God encounter? How about that? That's huge. And so I found this on Facebook. That just spoke to me. I hope that's not blasphemous. It spoke to me. Whoever we are, we're going to bow the knee to Jesus. Is that true for you this Christmas season? Will it be true? Will there be something in your life that you need to say, "I bow my knee again at the cradle and at the manger, and I just want your will in my life. If I don't get what I want, I don't care. I just want your will." That's a God encounter. And then finally, when I think of God encountering us, I think of this. Hello, a unique breakthrough miracle in all of our lives. We all need what we cannot do. Miracles, grace coming to you, provisions, open doors. I want to raise your expectations a little bit here this morning to say, wow, could it be that God has a unique breakthrough miracle for you? And I'm going to suggest he does. I think it was Pat Threet that shared with me, and if you're listening, Pat, I'm stealing your thunder. She had a blessing bag, and she passed somebody on the street, and they backed up, and they went back to this, I guess, a homeless person, a street person, I don't know, and they gave him a blessing bag, and the person just started crying and said, "This is the best thing that's happened to me all year." A blessing bag. I don't know what kind of open door kind of things you've had with those, but I just love to hear testimonies like that. For that person, it was a breakthrough. And then Pat shared with me, it was a breakthrough for me. I felt the pleasure of God when I did that. What breakthrough things are awaiting you this Christmas season? God only knows. But trust him. Expect things in your life. Now, just a couple of words about, well, how do you go about that? It's like, how do you expect the unexpected? I want to suggest a couple of things to you, and I don't think they're on the screen. I want to suggest this. Number one, never despise small things in your life. Never despise those daily things that you just know are the hand of God. Do not despise. Maybe you don't see angels. Maybe you're not going to have this healing breakthrough. I don't know. But never despise small things. And by the way, never say, "God can't do that in my life." I hope if anything, I communicate God can do anything he wants in our lives. Amen? So never say, "Oh, that's impossible. I don't want to be like Zechariah." Right? When Gabriel said, "This is going to happen in your life." "Oh, I don't believe it." He paid the price for 9 months. I don't want to be like that. We want to be like Mary, who said, "Let it be according to your word." let it be, Lord. So a unique breakthrough. Never despise things. Never get critical of what God can't do in your life. And then here's something that kind of, I always need to hear this. It's ask God for spiritual eyes to recognize encounters with him. Ask God for spiritual eyes to recognize things that you've never seen before. That could be a huge step in kind of identifying being encountered by God every day. Just asking the Lord, give me eyes, give me emotions, give me direction to recognize. That's you. That's you. You know, I love stories where celebrities or politicians were not recognized. I've shared this a trillion times. I have a friend who was, I don't know if he's still on the Oregon coast. I've lost track of Wayne and Laura. I should stay up on Facebook with him. Selling real estate on the Oregon coast. And guy walked into his office, said his name was Kevin. Wayne goes home for lunch, tells his wife, Laura, this guy by the name of Kevin Costner was in the office. I didn't know who he was. I just said, yeah, we've got some properties. He seemed to want some high-end property on the Oregon coast. And Laura, his wife, goes, what? Kevin Costner was in the office this morning? Wayne goes, yeah. Like, who's that? Who's that? And it was Kevin Costner, the actor. I'm not saying he's an angel. It was like recognizing a person like that was right in their office. Do you recognize God? Do I recognize God? In the Word, in everyday life, do I recognize his voice when he speaks? So that's always a challenge, but I want to, like Simeon, have this growing expectation, and boy, did he encounter God in a powerful way. Now, bullet point number two, expectations this Christmas. Expect to be led to bless others. In fact, it sounds so simple. I should just go on, right? Expect to be led. This whole event was a worship event for Simeon, and we'll talk about personal fulfillment later. It was a worship event, but it was also a blessing to people in the temple, and I want you to note at verse 33 and verse 34 that Simeon blessed Mary and Joseph, and what a confirmation that must have been for them. These prophetic words, the fact that he's standing and holding like a baby dedication, he's standing and holding the hope of Israel and speaking words of adoration and praise over this baby. Yeah, Mary and Joseph got it, but I don't think the other people in the temple got it. Mary and Joseph got it, but it's blessing them. It's a confirmation to them. So this bullet point, this Christmas, how are you going to be good news of great joy to other people? How am I going to be? How am I going to be uniquely led, as Simeon was, to bless other people? Now, I want to have a little fun with you because I know what you're thinking right now. Right? You're thinking, oh yeah, Christmas season, Pastor. I've already sent out my Christmas cards. All right, good. I think that's wonderful to do that. I do. We don't particularly, but I think that's part of Christmas celebration, do that. Pastor, I've already put together the one-page information letter of what we did this year. Okay, great, great. And you sent that out. Great. And it is a blessing. I'm not putting that down. I'm not being sarcastic, right? Pastor, I've got this Facebook post that I'm going to post this coming week to you and yours. Wait, I can hardly wait. I'll go to Facebook every day looking for it, right? Listen, all of that's a part of Christmas. I am not sarcastically putting it down. Do it. Make the cookies for next week, but make the cookies for your friends, and just don't make any fruitcake. Friends don't give fruitcakes. Just don't do that. Do all of those things that you're going to do this Christmas season It's part of your ritual. It's part of your tradition. It's good. But that's not what I'm after. There's a unique verse in this text. I believe it's verse 27, where it says, Simeon was inspired by the Spirit to do something unusual and unique. Now, in my introduction, I said it had been revealed to him, because that's what I, what is it, verse 27, it's been revealed to him that he would not see death. I think that happened way prior to this temple visit. I think it happened like a year before this event. I just think it was a part of his background even. But this verse, what is it, verse 28? Or is it verse 27? Inspired by the Spirit, he moves into the temple, and I'm going to suggest to you how I interpret that verse is this. It was not on his calendar. Do I hear an amen? It was not on his goal for the week. I'm all for goals and calendars. It was not on his daily planner. Oh, yeah, I went to see Jesus today. Like we kind of do that coming to church. This, I'm going to suggest to you, was a Spirit-anointed, spontaneous moment when all of a sudden the Holy Spirit says, there he is. He did not have a heads up that Mary and Joseph were coming to the temple that day. It was a unique moving of the Holy Spirit. And that's what I'm after. I want to raise your expectations about being moved and led by the Holy Spirit this Christmas season. Now, I'm going to unpack three or four things. In fact, they are three or four things that I've said a trillion times, but I'm going to say them again. This Christmas season, what could that mean to be a blessing to other people besides the fruitcakes and the cards and the one-page information letter and the Facebook post? What could it be? All right, number one is I'm going to suggest as a general thing in all of our lives, let's do this. Let's be open more than ever to his leading. More than ever before in your life and in my life, let's say, Holy Spirit, lead me this Christmas season. All right? I'll come back to that at the end of this little section. Number two is this. I'm going to suggest that here's what could happen in your life, that you're going to find yourself blessing with prophetic and encouraging words upon people. Now, I just dropped a grenade on you. Blessed with, what do you mean blessed with prophetic words? Like you're going to try to predict somebody's future? That isn't the total meaning of prophecy. But that's what he does here. He encourages them and he prophesies to them. Normally when you find yourself critical or frustrated and you speak out of that, or when you just want information from somebody, or when you just want to say something to be heard, you will find yourself, and I pray that you do, and I pray that I do, you will find yourself speaking into people's lives, and you don't even know where that's coming from, except the Holy Spirit within you. And that, my friends, is a budding gift of prophecy, and the Bible says that we should all covet spiritual gifts, especially to prophesy into somebody's life. Now, don't worry, I'm not getting any words of knowledge. I don't know any secrets of anybody's life. Don't worry. Unless God reveals something. But so far, that hasn't happened. I just want you, I love what Steve Backlund of Bethel Church says. Prophecy is encouragement on steroids. I like that. When was the last time you even just encouraged somebody to keep walking in their faith? To keep doing what they're doing. That could be a prophetic word to somebody. You never know when you say something to somebody, how they receive it, and they're going, how did they know? How did they know? I think many of you are prophetic, and you don't have a clue that you are. But you are. Because the Holy Spirit's working in you. So I just want you to think about, You may have an experience this Christmas season leading up to Christmas going, I don't know why I'm supposed to say this to you, but I'm supposed to say this to you. and it's like fuel on somebody's fire. It is not a word of your frustration. It is not a word of criticism. It is meant to build somebody up. And that's going to happen in your life. Number three, how about this one? I didn't even want to mention this because it sounds so much like oatmeal. It sounds so bland. Sacrifice with your time and your energy. Oh, yuck. Right? Can't you say anything deeper than that, Pastor? You know something? I found in my life, and I believe in financial giving. I tithe, I give to other venues as well. And I'm not bragging, that's just a statement. It's okay to say you tithe and you give financially. But I have found it's a whole lot easier to throw money at something than it is to give my time and my energy. It's a whole lot easier. And this Christmas season, I think God's going to lead me to sacrifice some of my time and my energy. And I hope it's on a great day when I'm out fishing, maybe, like I was. Never mind, I won't do that. Sacrifice your time and your energy. You may get a call from your kids going, can you watch the grandkids? And you're going, no, we can't. And why can't you? Well, our favorite TV program is on, that's why. I mean, it may be as simple as that. That would be a huge blessing, I think, to them. I want to give you one more about this, about blessing people and having an expectation to be led to pray with unusual zeal for somebody. Your prayers are a gift to the Lord. They may not know it. You may have an experience this week or next week before Christmas. You don't know why you're waking up at 3 a.m. and somebody's on your mind. Somebody's on your mind at 3 a.m. Don't be surprised about that. Don't be surprised you get up in the morning. Why am I supposed to pray for Bob? Why am I supposed to pray for him? You may not even know, but you're just being led of the Spirit to pray for somebody in particular. How many of you pray for people that aren't walking with the Lord Jesus Christ right now? And you're concerned for them. Not just praying for their healing of physical this and physical that, which I do, and I think you do too, but you're praying for things in people's lives. Now, I tried to unpack 3 or 4 things, and then I'm going to go to my third bullet point here, about blessing this Christmas that is unusual, that is Spirit-inspired, that you know God's in it, and He wants you to do it. Well, Ross, how do you do that? I want to go back to that first thing. You make yourself available to the Holy Spirit and say, lead me. You make yourself available. How many times have you driven by that ice cream shop and you go, I'd really like to try their ice cream. Do I have any takers on that, right? Right? Well, how are you going to try their ice cream unless you make yourself available in their parking lot and you walk in the door? So I had a little reffing thing up in Absorkey Friday afternoon. It was pretty simple, pretty easy. But I told the guy I was taking up there, I said, why are we, I mean, going by Columbus and going over the river like it's mid-50s, why are we doing this when we should be on the river? And I should be at the church, right? Guess what was calling me yesterday afternoon? I wasn't successful, but remember what I preached last week? People pay thousands of dollars to go on our rivers. Why am I wasting a beautiful afternoon? I didn't catch anything, but December the 5th, mid-50s, being able to fish on the Stillwater. There are better things in life, I know, but that is awesome. Listen, you've got to make yourself available to the Holy Spirit. You've got to get out of your little depressions. You've got to get out of your feeling of sorry for myself this Christmas season and say, Holy Spirit, fill me and use me in a powerful way. Now, I've got third bullet point here. I'm not gonna finish until I'm done with this one. And I'm going to put something on the screen that's going to catch some of you off guard. I've talked about in being encountered by God, being led by the Spirit to bless, as Simeon was. And now I'm going to talk about a third thing of raising your expectation, and it's this. Expect personal fulfillment in your life. Expect personal fulfillment. I want to walk you through Simeon here in a moment. In some of these verses, I just want to walk you through. I want to talk about personal fulfillment as I finish this message. Okay, first of all, look at verse 28. This is kind of his first step of personal fulfillment. It's a worship moment. He took Jesus up in his arms and he blessed God. I want you to think about something for a moment. Of all the things that he longed to do in life, this was his fulfilling moment to hold the hope of Israel in his arms. I could say it doesn't get any better than that. What prophets long for, he's holding. He gets to hold Jesus. And yes, Jesus was quiet and tender, never shed a tear, right? No wonder that Simeon says, verse 29, Lord, let me depart in peace. I don't think Simeon was saying, let me get out of the church service and get out of the parking lot and no one bother me. I think you know what that verse means. He's saying, I'm done. Let me go to heaven now because I have seen the fulfillment of my life and I've experienced life to the fullness. He's walking in personal fulfillment here. And verse 30, mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which you prepared in the presence of all peoples. He is seeing the glory. He's holding the glory of God. Do you want the knowledge of the mystery of the pyramids, or do you want to hold the glory of God? The glory of God. It didn't get any better than that. Now, I want to talk about personal fulfillment because he is walking in a sense of personal fulfillment. So much so that he says, I'm done. You can take me anytime, Lord. There isn't anything left to accomplish on earth. I've done it. I've seen it. If we use the Christian phrase, Simeon would say, I've arrived. I'm not perfect, but I've arrived. This is fulfillment. I'm talking about fulfillment here. Now, because I put this on the screen, I'm going to preach about personal fulfillment for a moment. I am not preaching this to make you feel good. I'm not. I'm preaching on personal fulfillment because, to me, it's a biblical truth, and Simeon is walking in it. Aren't we all fulfilled in Christ? Yes, we are. But here's where I'm going with this. Was Simeon fulfilled in his desires? I believe he was. Was Handel fulfilled when he completed the Messiah? Not to the completion that Simeon was, but Handel said, I think I've done something here. I am not raising the Messiah to the level of Holy Scripture. I don't think Handel was in a trance writing it. I think he erased things. I think said that doesn't feel right to me. But I think he sensed, I've touched the glory of God here in this. There's a fulfillment. So when I talk about personal fulfillment, I want you to know my heart. This is not self-actualization. It is not psychobabble. I am not trying to talk about a spiritualized ambition or glory that if you achieve so much, you'll really feel good about yourself. That is not what I'm talking about, though it can be interpreted that way. This is why I'm preaching on it. Yes, we are fulfilled in Christ. Yes, we are. But here's why I'm preaching on it. We all have undone things that await fulfillment. We all have undone things. I don't want this to sound crude or crass, but it's going to sound that way. You ain't dead yet. You're not. You still have things that yet to be fulfilled in you and through you for the glory of God and for other people. All of us have unfulfilled things that you'd like to. I'm not talking about your retirement bucket list, by the way. If you need encouragement, go watch Secondhand Lions. What's a good movie? I am talking about spiritual, ministry, tasks, relationships that aren't fulfilled yet and await the completion either for you or through you. So I'm going to unpack this, and then I'm going to finish with a personal story. What could it mean to say, what could it mean, expect personal fulfillment as you walk in these days in Christmas? All right? Number one, as your pastor, I would say with all of us, something with Christ gets resolved. That's a huge statement right there. I believe it's something that you never thought you could experience from the Lord Jesus Christ. It could be a healing. It could be an impact of His love and His glory on your life. It could be a spiritual gifts that you've never seen operate through you. It could be just revelation from the Word and from things that you never thought I would understand that. I still don't get the Trinity. I believe it. I still don't get it. This is the cycle day, isn't it? Toys with tots. Yeah. Something with Christ yet is to be fulfilled in you. None of us would say, I've arrived. I know everything. I've prayed everything. Right? I did walk on water yesterday. There were spots of ice there, and I could stand on them, and they held me. Man, I hope this Christmas season that all of us would say, Lord Jesus, you have more for me. Bring it on. Number two, what does it mean to walk in personal fulfillment and expect that? That something with another person gets clarified, resolved, or forgiven. Maybe you never heard from another person, I love you. Maybe you never said that to somebody. Maybe there's a clarification from 5 years ago, and I'm just making it up, but if it's prophetic, don't blame me. There's a clarification from 5 years ago that needs to get resolved, and somebody's going to show up and give you an apology. I'd take that if I were you. I'd take that. Something's going to get resolved. Something's going to get for. Maybe you're going to forgive something from somebody that this Christmas season you're going to say, it's done. I no longer have any pain about it. That'd be huge. That's talking about personal fulfillment here. You thought I was going to talk about money and getting rich, didn't you? It's personal fulfillment. You can't buy this. You can't. This is what God wants us to walk in. Where maybe these days leading up to Christmas, you'll go, wow, that was worth it. I don't know. I just have a sense that some of you are going to be saying in a couple of weeks, this was worth it. This is gold to me. The third thing I want to give you is that a desire or a dream gets reawakened. Proverbs 13:12 says a desire fulfilled is a tree of life. A desire, a new desire, a godly desire gets awakened in you. And then Psalm 37:4, take delight in the Lord and He'll give you the desires of your heart. I think sometimes when preachers preach on this, congregations or some audience hears that the preacher just means, whatever desires on your heart, go for it. No. There's fleshly desires, sinful desires that lead us all down a dumb path. But there are godly desires that God puts in you, that I believe that God wants to reawaken in you. I'm supposed to say this, a desire to sing. I don't know who that's for, a desire to sing. And you have been frustrated, and either you don't know how to sing, or you just think it's stupid, but it's a desire, and then you keep squelching it because that's never been a normal path, and the Holy Spirit's going to open up a desire for you to sing in a way that you've never sung before. I don't know where that came from. No, I know where it came from. A godly desire that's getting reawakened. Personal fulfillment. Expect that. I want to finish with a personal encounter with fulfillment with the Lord that is going to sound weird to you. It's going to sound mystical. And I'm not going to use the person's name, though they were remotely and historically attached to this church years ago, not even in so much even in my pastorate, but I did know them and visited with them. Here's the thing, she passed away. I can't remember if we, and don't come up to me after the service and say, who was that? Because I ain't going to tell you. It's not important. She's important. She's in eternity right now. Her and her husband are very special. Visit them. And I remember having a service for him, but I don't know if we had a service for her. And she died before he did. Even if we did have a service for her, there was closure, and I'm not talking about grief. I know what grief is. This wasn't grief. There wasn't. Maybe it's about closure, but I'm going to describe it to you. It's going to sound really weird. This is not a Christmas story. It was actually in the springtime. I was home for lunch, and I knew where her gravesite was in a cemetery. And it's like the Lord said, go and give thanks for her life over her gravesite. What? I always do that. I mean, I don't always do that, but I always give thanks to God for people. And in case you're hearing or filtering things I'm saying, I'm not talking about talking to dead people. You don't talk to old Aunt Martha. She's in eternity in heaven, right? You talk to the Lord. He can communicate anything he wants to them, but you talk to the Lord. But I just distinctly heard, give thanks for her life over her gravesite. And so I drove down to the cemetery, and if this remotely sounds vague, or I may have shared this before, it took probably 5 minutes, maybe 10 minutes, and I just stood there, and I just gave thanks to God for her life. Her life, what she did in the church, what she did in her faith, what she did in the later years of her life where she struggled with illnesses, perhaps dementia. I just gave thanks to the Lord. That's all I did. But there was something about going to her gravesite, doing that. I walked away, and I felt. I'm describing something mystical here for me. I felt like I touched the hem of his garment. I felt the power of God come upon me like something was fulfilled in me. And something was fulfilled in the courts of heaven. I don't know what that was, but something got fulfilled. And why do I remember that? That probably happened 15 years ago. Why do I remember it? Because it was a God moment. I want you to expect God moments where you sense you've touched the hem of his garment. And power is released upon you. You don't have to go to the gravesite. It just could happen in your quiet time. Could happen as you're walking and driving and doing all your daily stuff, doing laundry. Right? I'm trying to raise your expectations. Sometimes we don't know what to expect. But let's expect to be encountered by God. Let's expect to be a blessing to people. Let's expect some personal fulfillment in our journey with Jesus. Lord Christ, we just come before you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for revealing things to us, through us, around us. Thank you as we journey in this Christmas season that we will do so with a greater sense of acknowledging you, encountering you, if that means right now all of us would pray silently, I need to rededicate my life to you, Jesus. I need to expect something of fulfillment in me, through me, to bless other people. Do it, Lord. Bring it on. Our expectations of walking with you every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. Do it, Lord. If there is a person here this morning who has never opened up their life to Jesus Christ, who has never said, be my Savior, be my Lord, I want the assurance of forgiveness of sin, I want the assurance of everlasting life, I just pray that whether they're on Facebook or watching this or in this sanctuary, that you would just lift your hand to the Lord and say, I need Christ in my life. I just need him. I need that blessed assurance. I've never invited Christ into my life. If that's your humble prayer, then just say, Lord Christ, I humble myself at the manger that you would come into my life and forgive me of sin. And then I think all hands would be raised in this next prayer to say, Lord, I need to rededicate my life. I need to rededicate my life to you this Christmas season. I am so frustrated. I am so despondent. I am so something that does not reflect your love and your goodness that we all say, Lord, we rededicate our lives to you. We just say, Jesus, we need you more than we've ever needed the power and presence that you so graciously give. Do it, Lord, in our life. We dedicate our lives to you this morning. In your precious name, Jesus, amen. Amen. Well, let's all stand, and we're going to sing, O Come, Let Us Adore, the simple chorus, O Come, Let Us Adore. Well, I'm going to dismiss you with a blessing. And remember, those of you that will vote on this budget, just stay back. We'll do in 5 minutes a congregational meeting. May the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you, and give you peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Amen.